Welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Brad Nelson, which seems like at this point, as usual, Luis is off winning tournaments to make sure that he catches up to you in Player of the Year race. So I'll have to do with the next best thing, I guess. That being most likely Player of the Year. You want to say anything to the viewers before I cut you off again, Brad?
No, I'm good.
All right.
Nice to be back, though.
All right. You do get the honor of doing the hit or myth segment with me today. That being, we look at the rares, / mythic rares, rather, from Scars of Mirrodin, and, you know, how does it feel? Does it feel mythic? Does it not feel mythic? Luis is usually pretty good at this, but, you know, we'll accept what is most likely Player of the Year in his stead. How's that sound?
That sounds good.
All right. Start at the top of the list. We've got Elspeth Tyrell. I mean, it's a planeswalker. Obviously feels kind of mythic.
Yeah. I mean, obviously it's a mythic, but it's not as powerful as, like, most planeswalkers go. If there was one planeswalker so far that, like, could actually be a rare for the first time, it would probably be Elspeth.
Wow. That's saying a lot. You don't think Liliana Vass or Chandra Blaze could have just been a rare and nobody would have minded?
I like the interaction of, like, Chandra. Like, Chandra feels mythic, and, like, Elspeth doesn't really. Like, making guys is cool, but we have Conqueror's Pledge already. Gaining life is awesome, but, like, there's a ton of life gain in the format. And, like, blowing everything up is what makes that card mythic. The other abilities don't feel that powerful to me, and it has a low loyalty when you're trying to be aggressive with it, and it can't protect itself when you're trying to, like, keep it alive. So, I mean, I've killed a lot of those limited and constructed. I've never really had a tough time beating that card. It's never beaten me yet, and I've played against it, you know, half a dozen times.
Yeah, and at this point, it really seems like only mythical cards that don't exist could possibly beat Brad Nelson. I mean, it has to be a very mythic rare in order to be able to beat you. But nonetheless,
I mean,
it's a planeswalker.
It's pretty mythic.
Yeah. There you go. Well then. Moving on, we've got Geff. He's a big legend guy, eats stuff out of graveyards, puts into play. It seems pretty mythic, I think, flavor-wise, in my opinion.
Flavor-wise, it is. Like, that's, like, the perfect mythic rare to me. It doesn't need to be just constructed playable to be mythic. I think it should just be flavor-wise and powerful. And what it does in the game, like, it ends games if it's not dealt with. You know, you just start stealing guys, and stealing those guys gets you to more guys, and he just pretty much just gets to pilfer a person's entire, you know, deck. And I like that feel of that card, and it feels like an Una, but a little bit stronger, because you just get to pick and choose, and everything's always changing, the game state's always changing with it, so it keeps the game active and changing and adapting, and new situations arise. So even though it's beating the person, it still is having a fun impact on the game.
Yeah, that's cool. I think it kind of captures everything at that point. It's a name, it's a person you can relate to, and it has a very splashy, unique effect that really kind of has the game revolve around it. Moving on, let's talk about one that I think is definitely a whiff, but I'm interested to hear what you think, and that's Indomitable Archangel.
Yeah, it's not really mythic. I think for having to get Metalcraft for her, I think she should just give artifacts and her, you know, Shroud. It feels like a good rare. I mean, I could see they're pushing the Metalcraft theme and they wanted Metalcraft mythics and stuff like that, but, like, you put Sunblast Angel beside her and, like, it feels like they should just be swapped.
Well, what about, like, Ardent Sphinx? You got a 4-power flyer, 4/4, with a Metalcraft ability. It's just in a different color. That one's rare.
Yeah, it seems more mythic than Indomitable Angel. Like, I haven't been too impressed with the creature except for it's a 4/4/4 flyer. And, you know, usually, like, a white 4/4/4 flyer is under-costed, but these days every color has something that big, so it doesn't feel that, like, amazing to me.
Myth. Myth all the way. Let's flip the tables now on one that's obviously amazing. We're talking about Koth the Hammer now.
I've came full circle on that guy.
Really?
At first, I thought he was amazing, and then I wasn't too impressed, and right now I will be going back to my hometown where I haven't played game day or Magic in general forever, and I'm going to play game day. with Boros, and I've got some Koths in the sideboard that I've just been excited to play with. So I love that guy. He does mythic things. He turns your lands into threats. He produces enough mana to play another mythic spell, and he just has a great impact on the game. Everything about that guy screams mythic.
No more need to be said. It's obvious.
Yeah.
We're moving on to now what I think is probably one of the two cards that I initially didn't think was mythic, just because it didn't feel like it to me. Liege of the Tangle. How do you feel about that guy?
I thought you were going to go to the big blue guy now, but I think Liege of the Tangle is mythic. Have you ever activated him?
See, that's the thing, is I haven't.
I've done it a couple times, and it's so impacting on the game. Like, it does cost, you know, infinite mana to get into play, but like once it's there, like 8 toughness is a lot to build up to block him, and just 1 point of damage just gives you a force to deal with. And he reminds me of why I really like the 8 mana costing guys from Shards of Alara. Like, they're big, they impact the game, they're mythic, they're not going to be competitive, but like when you see them, it is interesting enough to have it at that rarity level. So that guy's mythic all the way. He's like the perfect mythic card.
I can see the argument there. I definitely see where it comes down all of a sudden. Just like the game changes, kind of like Geth. All of a sudden, there's this.
Oh, it's so much fun to attack with him, and then just take all your lands and put them over the top of your creatures and just say go. It's like the best feeling in the world.
I'm sold. That seems good. What about Lux Cannon? That's the next one on our list.
There's nothing mythic to me about that card. It takes forever. It takes a ton of cards to get it going. I think the best thing about mythics is they're standalones. They can do the job on their own. And, you know, I've played against the card. It's every 4 turns. You get to kill something. It's not that impressive. Like, if there was a way to put dump mana into it or something, I could see it being mythic. But, like, generally to me, mythics are power on their own. Rares are the kind of cards that you want to use other cards to be better. It's kind of like Bitter Blossom versus Jace the Mind Sculptor. You know, one's not going to be that great on its own, but the other one's amazing.
Interesting. I think Bitter Blossom sometimes is pretty good on its own, but that's a different argument.
It won't win a game on its own, though.
Lux Cannon. I can understand it being mythic, but that's only because it's kind of one of those cards you're going to build a deck around. You're gonna make a Lux Cannon deck. You're going to completely make a strategy that centers around this one card. And
yeah,
that could be a mythic
rare. Grindstone deck centered around that card, but what's the difference there? Like, it's a card that you need to build an entire deck around? That doesn't feel mythic. That doesn't feel like something that you never see in the world of Mirrodin, you know?
Kind of seems like a homework assignment, really, but I understand what you're getting at. You know, when I talked to Luis about it, he made it out to be, like, you know, suitable mythic rare, but yeah, I think you've changed my mind on this. I think it's definitely way more of a miss than a hit here.
Mm-hmm.
All right, moving on, Mindslaver. This is a Mirrodin callback. It definitely seems mythic to me. This is a crazy ability that you only hear players talk about. It's got to be mythic.
Oh, yeah. My favorite story in Magic's history, like, if you just want to know my best story, it's a Mindslaver story, you know? Like, being able to take over an opponent's turn is very powerful and can just swing games back, and it's something that you can't really do in Magic. It's the only one of its kind. So, like, that card just screams mythic to me.
Oh, definitely. Hands down. And it's a great callback to an older set, which already kind of like builds on mythic rarity for me. It's like something as a new player, you've heard about it before, but you don't really know it. And usually I don't like when cards jump rarity. I think that's really bad for their value and their play, like just the number that are out there. But in this particular circumstance, I really think it works. I think making callbacks is a big deal, which segues perfectly into our next card being Molten Tail Masticore.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, there's nothing non-mythic about that guy. The only time you have a bad Masticore is if you're not playing it correctly, or if you just draw right away.
So there's like, so you're saying there isn't so much a bad Masticore, there's only a bad Masticore player?
Yeah.
Something's only gone wrong if you've made it go wrong. Otherwise, that card just kind of wrecks when it's in play.
Yeah. Masticores have always been like one of the most powerful creatures in the game. And to get a mythic Masticore, it's just a perfect time for that kind of a card. They've all been good, and they will always see play in some kind of a deck. And right now, I don't think anyone's actually like stood up to the challenge of making him as mythic as he actually is. So I'm waiting for the deck that just breaks, you know, him beyond where he's at right now.
Exciting. And again, guaranteed mythic. Perfect. Another one on the Magic history list, we're talking Mox Opal. It seems like, even if it's terrible, unlike Masticore, it seems like it should be mythic.
I'm not with you on that one.
Whoa! A Mox that's not mythic. Please do give me the argument.
Alright, well, it is a Mox, but it doesn't generate mana on its own. Like, Chrome Mox seems way more mythic than Mox Opal. For one, it's legendary, and legendary weakens the card. Most of the time, it has to have such an impact on the game, and like you can't generate the mana on like the turns you want to abuse it. You can't play a spell on turn like a 2-drop on turn 1 with this Mox, and that makes the card way worse. You have to invest 4 mana into a spell to actually get the mana advantage, and I just feel the downside to playability for it just makes it just another rare. If you were able to somehow not have to invest so much of your deck into turn one-ing something, then yeah, it's a mythic. Moxes are mythic, but it's the weakest Mox, and that just because it has that name doesn't mean it should be that that rarity.
See, that's interesting. I think that's a very good argument for playability versus flavor-wise, because in my opinion, flavor for Mox screams mythic rare. Like, that's what it should be. But I understand on the playability side and just, will this card ever actually do anything side, where if I'm a newer player and I open a mythic rare, I'm excited about it, sweet, it's a Mox, oh wait, does it actually do anything? To me,
yeah.
I guess there's an argument for it being rare. I just think that's just, all you've done is create a formula for a subpar mythic rare, but it's still mythic because it's a Mox. Like, just that concept alone kind of sets it apart from a lot of other cards.
Planeswalkers should all be mythic because they're planeswalkers, and that's like the big flavor of the game. But I don't think any other card has to always be mythic now because it's part of the same family. Like there's family members you don't want people to really see and put out there, and I think Mox Opal is that one.
Interesting. All right. Moving on to one more of those kind of old school connected cards, we've got Platinum Empyrean. This time it's not quite the angel, it's a big burly dude. But I gotta say, the artwork itself makes me feel mythic rare, but the card itself kind of makes me question how, I don't know, I'm not really sure.
I'm just waiting for the next article of mine where I'm not on Infernal Titan, I'm on that guy.
Really?
Because if there's a card in Magic, that's who I feel like I am right now.
Interesting. Ironically, your Player of the Year points total can change, and it can only go up and become larger. So I don't really know if that's quite the perfect fit for you, but I will definitely say you're pretty indestructible. Maybe you should be an indestructible guy. Eh?
Darkstill or something.
We are literally having the conversation that's going to make the next Photoshop picture of you on the show right now. I'm just, I hope the viewers enjoy that. Then next week when your article goes up, it's going to be whatever you decide here. Darksteel, awesome. You want Darksteel, whatever, the 3-3 flash guy? Do you want Brad with that right there? Or would you rather Platinum Empyrean?
I am not that fast.
Okay.
I don't think I could jump in front of anyone. But,
Meanwhile, you've got the 8-8 strut going on then? That's kind of your look right now, you think?
No, I don't have a strut. Do you, like, that, what's his name again?
Platinum Empyrean.
Yeah, he does not look like he moves with a strut.
I think that guy's out there strutting.
I think he's stomping. He looks really slow, and everyone knows he's there because he's making a lot of noise, but you don't want to get in front of him.
All right, that sounds a little bit more like Brad Nelson, which is mythic rare. I mean, so is this guy mythic?
Its ability makes it mythic. I think any time that you aren't able to be dealt damage, or it has a rule, like, whenever a card puts a rule on the game that is its only type, like Platinum Angel or Platinum Imperium, those feel mythic to me for the fact that, you know, oh, you can't lose life. You know, I can't do anything with my life total right now until that's gone. It's changing a rule of the game. And not a lot of cards get to do that. And so those feel very mythic to me.
Yeah, I mean, the game will center, in theory, will center around this card when it enters play. And I think the callback to the older mythic, definitely something that's its own independent rule that is now affecting the game, makes it mythic rare. I will give you that. It's a little clunky to cast, it's a little more awkward than the angel, but the fact that it has this ability definitely makes it mythic rare.
Oh, yeah.
So now, we've gone through some sweet callbacks, some good cards. Let's talk about, you know, the giant Quicksilver elephant in the room, that being big clone, Quicksilver Gargantuan. This, like, why is this guy mythic rare? I put him in the rare pile all day long. What the hell?
He's not mythic. He's a big clone. And I'm not saying he's a bad card, and I've played him in Limited, and he's become a 7/7 skin render, but I don't think copying another creature on the board makes anything mythic. Like, it's just you're downgrading to, like, a common or an uncommon or whatever's on the board that, I mean, you do become the best creature on the board, but unless it's a mythic, why are you turning your mythic rare into something else? Like, I think the whole thing about mythic is the power of itself and things like that. So making a card like that, you know, a mythic rare makes no sense to me.
No, I agree. I think a 7/7, you know, Plague Stinger, or a 7/7 even like Grand Architect or something like splashy and limited could be cool, but that's pretty much where this card ends, and it definitely doesn't feel like a mythic rare. Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk about Skitherix, the Blight Dragon. How about that guy? What do you think there?
I don't think they should have ever printed it.
Oh, okay.
I hate that card. it steals trophies.
Wow. Skitherix, the trophy stealer.
Yeah, he's mythic all the way. He's the biggest infect creature. He can't die. He has haste. He's got flying, like... He screams mythic. He's unbeatable.
He's one of those cards that people will talk about.
There's a couple ways to deal with him. In Limited, even in Constructed, I can see him making an infect deck possible because he can kill you on his own.
Right.
And, I think infect should have had a mythic rare, and he's about as good as he could have gotten.
And you would prefer this guy over, let's say, they kind of like swapped it and made like Hand of the Praetors mythic and then made this guy like slightly smaller or something. Like, you still like the big dragon.
Yeah, for the same argument that you don't need other cards to like make it as powerful.
Yeah, does it?
Like, I like the feel of standalone mythic rares. You know, not needing any other cards to become powerful. That's what it is to me.
Yeah, it makes sense. This guy is the total package. Regens, flying, haste, you know, wither your guy, he eats him up. It's all there. We got another callback card next. We've got Sword of Body and Mind, starting to like complete the sword cycle, I guess, is what it's going to be now in the bigger scheme of things. Seems kind of mythic. I mean, people talk about Sword of Fire and Ice and Sword of Light and Shadow as like these cards you got to get for EDH and formats like that. So this card feels the same way.
Yeah, from the past, how many times people have played with swords, it just proves that it is kind of a mythic. It is, it does something that other cards don't, and it, you know, it's just an amazing card, and there's no reason why that's not a mythic rare.
The one play that I like on this one and the other ones is it makes new bodies to put the sword on, which I think is really what kind of puts it over the top. It's like, it's not a mediocre sword, there's no argument for it being bad, because it's like, it's no longer an equipment, it's now a 4/4 body almost all the time as soon as you hit somebody once.
I mean, I wish it wasn't milling, because if you're connecting with the card, they're probably going to die around the same time you mill them out.
Yeah.
But it's still a great card, because it gives you a 2/2 body.
Yeah, I agree, like, just on the card itself, if you change that mill effect to almost anything else, like, even if it was, like, the Frost Titan ability, it would make the card... it would make the card better... But I think that the mill 10 feel is kind of a mythic feel. Like, people talk about Glimpse the Unthinkable as one of those cards, like, similar to how I talk about Mindslayer, where it's a card in Magic's history that does something kind of cool and unique, and, you know, Sword now has that. So it makes it more mythic, in my opinion.
Yeah, for sure.
Venser the Sojourner is second from the last one here. This one seems pretty obvious, too. I mean, it's a Planeswalker with a very unique ability, and it's a callback to an older card. Home run, right?
What card?
Venser the Sojourner.
Oh, callback from Venser itself?
Yeah.
Yeah, Venser always seemed mythic to me. It was a great card, and this guy's pretty decent. I haven't really gotten to play with him much, but... I mean, just because he's a Planeswalker, I don't think Planeswalkers should ever leave the rarity they're in, so.
That's, Luis and I have talked about that topic before, about where Planeswalkers should be, and if they have the kind of, you know, effects and power levels they have right now, I completely agree they should stay Mythic Rare. And that's this guy, you know, he does that. He does exactly what you expect. Lastly, we've got the Everyman's Titan, a card that I think you can make an argument either way. You got Worm Coil Engine.
It should have never been printed, but yes, it should be Mythic.
Just because it's so dominating and limited, it should just never happen? Or is it... What's the argument?
No, it's because they came out with the Titans, and I think the Titans were just developed... they're perfect. They did this effect that the color needed, and they all had two abilities, and they were just 6/6s for 6, which you don't see that much. And they were awesome. I loved every single Titan. The flavor and the reason that they were made was just perfect. And then they come out with the colorless Titan, and that's just very powerful and does its own thing. Like, I didn't see why it had to be made. I think it's too good, too big of an impact, and too similar to a cycle of creatures that they made that were, for a long time, a very good original cycle.
No, I definitely see that argument. I think, you know, I have to wonder if it was... a 4/4 for 6, and it made 2/2s, would it be that much worse? I mean, would it see less playability because you can't live through Destructive Force?
Yeah.
But...
It would see less play because it's not a 6/6, I mean...
You have Lifelink Death Touch, which are two really strong abilities in Standard right now, and then it creates more of them. I think that those two keywords really push this card over the top. If it was just a vanilla 6/6 that made two vanilla 3/3s, I don't think it would see nearly as much play. Not saying it's not Mythic Rare, but it's just, it's such a powerhouse the way it is right now. It's just like, it's a great card. Like, I'm building a lot of control decks where all of a sudden this guy just gets me back into games.
Yeah. But yeah, he's, for what he is, he's Mythic all the way. He's awesome, and he gets the job done, and I haven't beaten many times, and that makes him Mythic, because he just wins the game all by himself.
So overall, it seems like mostly hits out of this set. I mean, obviously, if you're starting with Mirrodin as a set, and you're starting with great callbacks to old cards with Moxes and Master Cores and Mindslavers, it seems like it would be hard to go wrong. And outside of, like, Bad Clone, I think you could make an argument for all these Mythic Rares being, you know, really good selections. Wouldn't you say?
Except Mox.
We'll be split on Mox. I'm fine with that. I would like to, you know, see some, you know, viewer debate, otherwise... The Brad Nelson Mox is terrible. Should not be. I should be opening it as a common in a pack and being like, oh, maybe I can use this in draft. Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. But no, it's good. I like it. I like that it's not home. You know, we're not 100% agreeing. I'm going to go try to make some 7/7 plague stingers in the meantime, though. All right?
Good luck.
Thanks for coming by, Brad. Glad to have you on the show. Pretty much as a regular at this point. And thanks, everyone, for watching. We'll see you next time.